Everybody, Pastor Jackson here. I wanted to take this opportunity to thank you so much for logging on or showing up today. I know that you're going to be blessed not only by the powerful worshiping experience, but by the practical word that will be explained that's designed to bless your life. So check this out. Get ready for a phenomenal worshiping experience today. Again, thank you so much for being with us.
Please stand for our mission statement.
The Antioch Missionary Baptist Church is a word-centered ministry existing to evangelize the lost, to equip and empower God's people, and to lead them to eternal salvation in Christ Jesus. We are the holistic ministry for our community. As Christ loves all people, our purpose is to reach out in love to everyone. Our goal is to make an impact locally, nationally, and globally, with a multi-ethnic, multicultural ministry, with the focal point being Jesus Christ. As Christ ministers to the total person, we strive to become an oasis of hope, addressing spiritual, emotional, and physical needs in tangible ways. Our model for excellence in all things is Christ. We commit ourselves to the spirit of excellence. We seek the highest, the finest, and the best that God has for us. We strive to honor Him and serve one another in the same spirit of excellence. Our commitment is to Christ, and our foundation is the Word of God in its entirety. We believe we can do what the Word says we can do, be who it says we can be, and have what it says we can have.
Just to know that He's allowed you to be in His house one more time? Are you grateful at home to be able to log on and give God glory? Then if you are, come on somebody, open up your mouth and let Him know how grateful you are. Hallelujah. We bless your name on today. Let's invite the presence of the Lord in this place. Father God, in Jesus' mighty name we come. We say thank you, Lord, for all that you are. And for all that you keep on doing for us, God, you're an amazing and an incredible God. and you're always worthy of praise. So we thank you. We thank you for how good you are. Even when our situations and our circumstances aren't good, you are good, and your mercy endures forever. So we thank you on today. God, we pray that as we sing and as we worship and as we dance and as we pray, oh God, that everything that we do will be done to bring you glory. As the word is preached, oh God, we pray that your power would fall, oh God. We pray that we would not leave this place the same way that we came, but that we will leave transformed, knowing that we've been in your presence. Bless that person that is logged on today, oh God. It wasn't able to be here in the house, oh God. Meet them at their point of need, oh God. Father, we thank you in advance for the blessing that we know that we will receive because we've been in your presence. So we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise, and we ask it all in Jesus' mighty and precious name. It is so. Amen. Come on, Zion, give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Let's make a joyful noise unto him. He's so worthy. We bless his name. We bless his name. Hallelujah. Come on, 10 o'clock. Let's bless him in his place. Hallelujah. Exalt you, O God. Glory and honor is due him. Say,
glory and honor is due him.
Oh, glory and honor is due him. Say,
glory and honor is due him.
Tell everybody, say, glory and honor is due him. Say,
glory and honor is due him.
Everybody say glory. Cause if it hadn't been for you, Lord, oh, if it hadn't been for you, Jesus, think about his goodness. Think about his mercy. Just take a minute to think about his goodness. Think about his mercy. His goodness and his mercy. We bless your name, God. We bless your name. We bless your name, God. Come on, right there where you are. Come on and open your mouth. Let him know how appreciative you are just to be alive. Cause he didn't have to do it. He didn't have to wake you up. He didn't have to give you clothes to put on. Didn't have to give you a place to live. Didn't have to give you food to eat. But he did. And somebody ought to tell him thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. 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 Don't want to ask you for anything. Just want to tell you thank you for what you've already done. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. So my hands are up. And my heart is open wide as the sky. We lift you high, oh God. We lift you high. Hands up, hearts open wide as we cry. God, we lift your name high. Somebody tell them this morning. Oh my God. Yes, God. Lord, we lift.
We lift you high.
Lord, we lift.
We lift you high.
Somebody ought to lift your hands in the sanctuary.
Let all the other names fade away.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Let all the other names fade away. Till there's only you. Let all the other names fade away. Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. Come on, Saturday.
Oh,
We lift you high. We lift you high. We lift you high. We lift you high. Our hands are up. God, we lift your name high. Somebody tell them this morning. Lord, we exalt
you.
We extol you.
We lift you high.
We honor you, Jesus.
We lift you high.
We bow before you.
We lift you high.
We love and adore you.
We lift you
high. Our hands are up. Oh my God. Depression and suicide, let it fade.
All the other names fade away.
Like divorce and abandonment, let it fade.
All the other names fade away.
Every name that's not yours.
Let all the other names fade away.
Let them leave our minds. Let them leave our minds.
Oh, my, 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 my.
This is our prayer, oh God. Have your way, Jesus. Have your way, Jesus.
Amen, amen, amen. Now, I like what you did there, Minister Sherry, because at the end of the song was talking about that all the other gods fade away. But then she started talking about things that we as Christians, we don't think about other gods. It's like, oh, okay, you know, Krishna, Buddha, all of, she was like depression, illness, our bills, our partners, our job, our wayward children, all these other things take the place of our focus that should be on God. We get distracted because we're thinking about, oh, how am I going to pay this bill? How am I going to live in this house with this person that's getting on my nerves? How am I going to deal with this boss on Monday? How am I going to deal with this child today? All of these things are taking our focus off of God. And when we focus on God, all those things will take care of themselves. So I don't know if you caught that at the end, but if you're distracted because you've got whatever that thing is on your mind, focus on God. I promise you it's about to be the best 2 hours you have had in the last week. Because when you leave, you're going to know exactly how to deal with whatever that thing was. Because you heard a word from the Lord, and now you're ready to take that thing on. And more importantly, you put it in His hands. But before I get distracted, I have a job to do. Let me not lose sight. Well, it is my pleasure and my privilege this morning to welcome all of our guests and our returning visitors to The Dwelling Place. Whether you're joining us this morning in person or online, we are so excited that you're here today with us. If you are joining us today in the sanctuary and this is your first time or you've been here a couple of times, we ask that you would stand and remain standing until the welcome has been fully extended. Okay, I was going to say, I know we have visitors. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Well, on behalf of our senior pastor teacher, Pastor Arthur Jackson III, good morning. His family and the entire Antioch family, we are so glad that you're here this morning worshiping with us. By now, we hope that you've come to realize that we are here to do nothing more than to lift and glorify the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, we know that you could be anywhere this morning, and we don't take that lightly. So it's our sincere hope and desire that if you do not know Jesus as your personal Savior or don't have a church home, when the invitation has been extended, that you'll come down the aisle and give a preacher your hand, but more importantly, give God your heart. Antioch family, let's give our guests another round of applause. Now, wait a second, guests. If this is your first time here, we ask that you remain standing for a couple seconds longer as our ushers have a Get Acquainted packet for you, and there's gifts and treats and stuff in there for you. So once you've gotten your packet from the usher, you are free to have your seat. And all across the building and online, we ask that you would text the word visitor if you are visiting either in person or online to 51555. That's visitor to 51555, because we want to keep in touch with you. So somebody from our AIM ministry will get in touch with you and we'll follow up. Now, Antioch family, let's give our guests another round of applause. We're just so excited that you guys are here today and worshiping with us. Finally, family, please be reminded that love offering envelopes are available for those that desire to be a tangible blessing to our pastor and his family. And at this time, we ask you to return your attention to the screens for this week's edition of ANN News. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Antioch News Network. I'm your host, Savannah Dre Smith. We're so glad you chose to join with us today. Need to know your deacon? Well, today, after each service, members whose last name starts with the letter C or D, you can meet deacons Robert Merrick, Aaron Campbell, Mike Connor, and Larry Thomas in the front lobby. Every Wednesday in June, we will be hosting our Fresh Voice Revival with awesome preachers from around the country preaching for the first time in the Dwelling Place. Pastor Anton Elwood of New Mount Zion Church in Tallahassee, Florida, Pastor Terry Mackey of Pilgrim Rest Baptist Church in Phoenix, Arizona, Pastor Alexis Stevens of the Faith Center in Orlando, Florida, and Pastor John Terris Tate of Mount Moriah Church of Los Angeles in Los Angeles, California. So get ready for Fresh Voice Revival every Wednesday in June at 7 p.m. in the Dwelling Place. Calling all men. We need all the men to register for the upcoming Man to Man Ironclad Conference on Friday, June 9th at 6 p.m. in the Gen Next Complex. There will be faith, fellowship, and the finals. That's right, Friday's NBA Finals game will be played on the screens. Then on Saturday, June 10th at 8 a.m., there will be sessions on family, finance, fitness, and wait for it, feelings. Yes, men have feelings too. So men, be sure to save the dates and invite a few friends or two. Now, First Friday Summer of Fun events are coming soon, starting with our comedy show on Friday, June 2nd with headliner Marcus Wiley.
The pandemic hit in March 2020. Actually, the country had shut down March 16th, 2020. Everything closed. That's everything got shut down. Very challenging, you know, on my family, my wife. It was very challenging for her because I married a young lady, beautiful, smart, intelligent, but I didn't marry for her cooking. I didn't marry for her cooking. And we had been living the blessed life, going out to eat 2-3 times a week. And so when the country shut down, ooh, it was tight on her. It was real tight on her. It was very tight because that's when we both realized, oh, you're not a cooker. You're a fixer. Watch this, yeah. Not a cooker, but a fixer. Yeah, cooking and fixing are two different things. Yeah, you fix tuna fish. You fix hamburger helper. You fix nachos. You fix tacos. A lot of men in here, ooh, my baby cooking tacos tonight. No, your baby fixing tacos tonight. Cooking is when you stuff something. Cooking is when you smother something. Cooking is when you saute something. Cooking is when you preheat the oven on 350 for 2 weeks. That's cooking.
So, if you like to laugh, you won't want to miss the comedy show. On the first Friday of July, our lip sync battle is back with a cameo appearance from Rob Marley and a $500 prize. Then, on the first Friday of August, is our Soul Lounge. Stay tuned for more information about our first Friday Summer of Fun events. There's more happening around Antioch. Let's take a look.
Good morning, Antioch family. Big Lip from Hot 105. Wait a second, excuse me. I'm in church. I forgot. My name is Alex Chisholm, Hot 105 FM host and member of Greek's Giving Glory Ministry. What do we do? Well, we raise money for Antioch's youth department, scholarships, field trips, laptops, and more. And we are so excited to extend an invitation to our upcoming fundraiser, the Masquerade Scholarship Ball. Last year's ball was epic, and we cannot wait to have even a greater experience this year. Help us support Antioch's youth department by either purchasing a ticket or becoming a sponsor of the ball. Stop at the table in the lobby to purchase your ticket. And don't be trying to sneak out. We'll be waiting for you.
We know three immutable characteristics of God. We know that he's omniscient. He knows all. We know that he's omnipotent. He's all powerful. We know he's omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. But there are two that maybe you don't know that I think I throw out at you for free. He's omnibenevolent. He is good to everybody. And then lastly, he is omniactive. He is always active in the affairs of my life and yours. Good news, he didn't stop working in your past. He didn't stop working in your yesterday. He kept the work going to your present day.
Amalek is not attacking Israel for what they are now. It is for what they can be in the future. Amalek is attacking the potential of Israel. Can I tell you, the devil knows you got potential. You're wondering why he's attacking you. You ain't got that much, but maybe you're finna get something. Maybe the devil knows that the Lord is about to blow you up. Maybe he's busy in your life because he knows it ain't gonna be that long now. God got a blessing with your name on it. Preach, Pastor.
Well, that's it for this week's edition of ANN. Don't forget to check out our app and Antioch Impact on Instagram to stay updated with everything happening around Antioch. And visitors, don't forget to text the word visitor to 51555 to stay connected with us. I'm Savannah Dre Smith, signing off. Enjoy the rest of service.
All of us, welcome our campus speaker, Pastor Ludenfeld.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. David declared, I was glad when they said unto me, come on, let us go up into the house of the Lord. Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord right now? I mean, don't fool me. I mean, you're really glad to be here in the house. You could have been someplace else, but God allowed you to come into the house of worship, to come into the house of prayer, to give him all the glory, all the praise, everything that is due to his name. Just look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I am here to give God praise. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm here to give him praise. You may be seated in the very presence of the Lord. Listen, first of all, let me just thank all of our visitors for coming. Amen. All of our visitors, you know who you are. Amen. Thank you so much for being a part of our service today. And whenever you get tired of coming, you're more than welcome to join and be a part of us. We'd be so happy to have you. Amen. So on behalf of our pastor and the official staff of the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, we welcome you to this
the 10 o'clock service of our dwelling place. Amen? Amen. Listen, we want to say a big thank you to all of those who sponsored, played, and participated in our golf tournament on Friday. Amen. Thank you all so much for your contribution, your help, and all of those who supported the golf tournament at the Pembroke Lakes Golf Club. Again, thank you so much, amen, for your participation. Somebody say next Sunday. Say next Sunday. Amen. Next Sunday is the 32nd pastoral anniversary of our pastor. Come on, let's give God some praise in this place. 32 years, amen, of pastor and people, and we are grateful for him laboring, amen, in this vineyard, amen, particularly with people like us. Amen. Yeah, we hard, you know, some folk hard to shepherd. Amen. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Some folk just hard. Amen to shepherd. But he's been here for 32. Yeah, y'all gotta give God some praise for that. Amen. He's been here, amen, for 32 years. And of course, Sunday is his special day. And so all day, but at 4 o'clock particularly, we're gonna come back. Amen. And we are going to show our appreciation. So I want all of our lead servants, our ministries, everybody, amen, get your gifts of appreciation prepared and come prepared to be a blessing, amen, to our pastor. Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise for that again. Of course, you know, there's nothing more that he would love than for all of us, amen, to come back at that 4 o'clock service. So that we can celebrate the tenure of pastor and people. Amen? So we want to do that. So keep that on your schedule for next week, Sunday. Did I say Sunday next week? Yes. All right. I just want to make sure y'all paying attention. Okay. Good. All right. Fresh Fire is coming up on Wednesday, the last Wednesday of this month, which is May 31st at 7 p.m. So the preachers and the intercessors are going to get together. It's going to be a wonderful time. Amen in the Lord. It's always a great time. So I'm looking forward to that. So I'm asking that you would prepare yourselves as well. Amen. To have, you know, let's have worship, praise, and a word from the Lord. And then, of course, our comedy show is taking place on the first Friday in June. That's June 2nd at 7 p.m. Amen. Listen, tickets are available. Amen. So you need to go and secure your tickets. You can do so immediately. Amen. After service. Amen. You can get, you know, you just saw the clip. Amen. It's going to be hilarious. Amen. It's going to be funny. So again, please secure your tickets. They're in the lobby and they're available. Men, we want you to sign, well, actually register for the Men to Men Ironclad Conference, which is going to take place on the 9th and 10th of June. Amen. So brothers, we want you to take care of that. Make sure before you leave here today that you sign up. Amen. We want you a part of that Men to Men Conference. Amen. All other announcements are on the app or on our website. So we want you to take advantage of those opportunities. Now is the time that we have set aside to actually lift up some persons that we need to be praying for. We want to continue to pray for the Cheney family, continue to pray for Winnie Testamark and all of those particular persons. But before we do, let the kids go. Can we just let the kids go quickly? Amen. Over to the Gen X complex. Amen. Can we do that? Amen. Thank you so much. Amen. I should have done that immediately after I welcomed the visitors. So youth workers, please forgive me. I know I'm robbing you of your time. Amen. But please do forgive me. Amen. Can we encourage the kids as they come? Amen. Let's give him some more encouragement. Amen. Amen. Now is the time we want to go before the Lord in prayer. Amen. And so So we're just praying for those persons that I've named and any other person that you may have on your mind or that's on the prayer list. Amen. The altar is open. You may come even now at this time as we prepare for prayer.
Second command that came from Jesus, he said, treat your neighbor as you do yourself. Love your neighbor as you do yourself. So instead of just praying for your family, your loved ones, I want you to do a selfless act for me. Pray for those that are standing next to you, in front of you, behind you, and remove self out of the way. And fulfill that second command from Jesus to love your neighbor as yourself. And as I pray the corporate prayer for everyone, please pray for me. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come now recognizing who you are, thanking you for who you are, for you are powerful, you're almighty, you're everywhere, and you know everything. So you know our hearts, Father. Before we come asking you for anything, Father, right now we want to give honor and praise to you for your presence in our life. We thank you for being the God that sent his only Son to save us from our sins. And he came in the presence of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ tore the curtain, broke the barrier, and he bridged the gap between us. We want to thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit, for he is the divine connection to us, to you. We want to thank you for your angels for protection and your word for direction. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come now asking you that you forgive us for our sins, that you continue to look past our fault and see our need. Heavenly Father, we come now in the humblest, earnest way we know to pray for one another because we're standing in the need of prayer. And Father, we believe right now that if we're praying for someone else, we will be covered too. So right now, cover us in their prayers. Father, we have those that's names that's on this list. Some needing one thing, some needing other things. We have those that's standing in front of us. They're standing in the gap for somebody or standing in the gap for themselves. We ask you right now to move your mighty hand, that your presence is here, that some lives will be touched, that someone will be healed, that someone will have their burdens removed. We know that you can do it right now, Father. We ask you, we're calling on your mighty name. We know that you can do it. We know that you love us. Continue to bless us. Continue to go with us. Continue to cover us. Father, we give you all the praise. The glory and honor is already yours. We ask it all in the matchless name of your Son, Jesus Christ, as we pray. Amen. And everybody love the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
for praying for you and with you on this morning. Amen. It's giving time. Amen. It's time that we give back to the Lord what he has so freely given to us. Amen. By way of our tithes and offering. Amen. If you could just look at your neighbor one time and say, neighbor, God loves a cheerful giver. So why are you not smiling? Amen. God loves. Y'all believe that?
Yes.
Amen. God loves a cheerful giver. The Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. That's what the text says, right? Give. Amen. And it shall be given to you. Amen. If you need an envelope now, just raise your hand wherever you are. And one of our ushers will come and swiftly hand you an envelope or make one available for you. Amen. If you need an envelope, just raise. I see hands going up. Amen. I see hands going up. In the front right here. Got hands going up. Amen. So much. Amen. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Eternal God, our Father, again, we're so grateful for this opportunity you afforded us to give back to you what you have so freely given to us, the things that you have lavished upon us. And so, God, we ask that you would bless our feeble attempts to give back to you what's yours. Bless it and keep it, we pray. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we stand together as we recite our prayer pledge on this morning? Amen. Together. Lord, I know that I can give you an offering only after I've given you the tithe. My giving reflects my total dependency on you and my obedience to your word. Though this seed leaves my hand, I believe by faith it will never leave my life. I will trust you, O God, by honoring you in my living and in my giving. By faith, I now stand in obedience to have blessings released, burdens removed, and benefits restored in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Those of you viewing by way of the internet, there are four secure and safe ways you can give in this way. now have a video presentation of our speaker after the choir. Then the choir will sing, then the preacher will come.
Melvin C. Dawson, Jr., a native of Dayton, Florida. He earned a Bachelor of Science degree from Bethune-Cookman University, Daytona Beach, in psychology with a minor in English. Pastor Dawson accepted his call to ministry in 1985. He serves as the founder and overseer of the Cathedral of Praise Church in Miami, Florida. He also serves as the Kingdom Connection Fellowship International State Overseer of Florida. He is founder of WILMA, Women Interested in Learning from a Man's Assessment, a monthly symposium for female ministers. He is married to Pastor A.K. Williams Dawson, father to Ariel, Melvin III, and Hakeem. Antioch, please welcome to the pulpit in the dwelling place, Pastor Melvin C. Dawson, Jr.
Oh, run right to you, oh God. Come on and give them glory today. Come on and give them honor today. For he is our source. He is our strength. He is our life. And so, Lord, we give you praise today. Come on, as we prepare for the word, give him glory. Give him praise in advance for what we believe by faith we're going to receive through the man of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Not some of my help, but all. Get your Bibles, if you will. Go with me to a very familiar passage of Scripture, a very familiar story. And yet I pray that the familiarity will not rob us that which God wants for us to hear. It is found in the book of Mark, chapter 9. I want to draw our attentions to verses 16 through 24. Mark 9, 16 through 24. It reads, and he asked the scribes, "What question ye with them?" And one of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth, and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not." He answered him and said, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me." And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, "How long is it ago since this came unto him?" And he said, "Of a child, and oftentimes it has cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said unto him, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And straightway, father, the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." Verses 22 through 24, again in the Amplified translation, says, "And it has often thrown him both into fire and into water, intending to kill him. But if you can do anything, do have pity on us and help us." And Jesus says, "You say to me, if you can do anything? Why, all things can be are possible to him who believes." At once the father of the boy gave an eager, piercing, inarticulate cry with tears and said, "Lord, I believe, constantly help my weakness of faith." Can I read those verses again in the Message translation? He asked the boy's father, "How long has this been going on?" "Ever since he was a little boy. Many times it pitches him into fire or the river to do away with him. If you can do anything, do it. Have a heart and help us." Jesus said, "If?" There are no ifs among believers. Anything can happen. No sooner were the words out of his mouth than the father cried, "Then I believe, but help me with my doubts." The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God shall stand forever. Pray with me for just a moment. Father, take us into this, thy most holy word. Declare unto us these thy gospel truths, so that when we have left this place, this building, this sanctuary, when we have left the virtual viewing screen and have turned it off for today, we can say we heard a word from you. And as a result of that, our lives are the better for it. We will be able to do your will and do it according to your way. So let the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart, allowed to be acceptable in our sight, O Lord, who is our strength and our Redeemer. This we ask in the marvelous, the glorious, the victorious, precious name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Those that love the Lord and know that all of your help comes from the Lord, say amen. Put those hands together. Give God praise and glory for being God the Creator, Jesus Christ, Redeemer, the Holy Spirit, which is our helper and keeper. While you're clapping, will you please praise God for the Spirit that rests, rules, and abides in the personality of your great leader, even in his absence today. Come on, give God praise for Pastor Arthur Jackson III. To all the ministers of the gospel, to all of you, my brothers and sisters, you may be seated in the presence of the Most High God. Once again, my hyena happy and peacock proud to have been invited back to this place, Antioch. Before I get started, let me just share this one thing real quickly. And I had one book in my car, just one book. And I said, let me take this book out so I can give it to the pastor. But it was so interesting to hear that your men observance is coming along. I've written a couple books, but I have a book, and I'm just going to ask you to go online, look it up on Amazon. But it's called The Hidden Hurt Man. It's a book I wrote for men in my counseling days of sharing with men. I understand that men who hurt are often hiding, and men who hide are often hurting. And so as a result of that, there's some information here that helps us. There's a chapter in here called Where Do Our Tears Go? Because men know from boyhood, we've been told men don't cry. Well, if we're not supposed to cry or can't cry, then where do our tears go when they are backing up in the reservoir of our souls and spirits? And then by the time we try to be a man, we're slipping in our own puddle. When we try to be a good father, we're slipping in our own puddles. When we try to be a good husband, we're slipping in our own puddles. There's a chapter called Sex, the Pain for Outlet. Because what we soon discover as men is that while sex can give us release, it does not always give us relief. There's a chapter in this book called Damn the Man Cave. Because somebody has told us, those of us who are supposed to be the king of our castle, that all we need to do is get one room in the house, put a billiard table in it, get some video games, and sit there and have our... No. If you're going to have a man cave, it may suggest that you are a caveman, which is the lowest on the Neanderthal totem pole. And while you're in your cave, where's the rest of your house? There's a chapter called I'm Sick of Denzel. I look at about six of his movies and I dissect it, because many women are trying to make your man be Denzel. That's just a fictional character. He ain't bigger than King Kong. There's a chapter here also called The Cracked Rib, because I've developed that women who are trying to help your man often have these issues of hurt and pain. Former basketball player, I understand cracked ribs is something the doctor can't really mend. He has to mend on his own. But those of us who've ever cracked a rib know it's very difficult to breathe. So woman, you're trying to help your man, but it's hard to breathe. You're trying to help your son, but it's hard to breathe. You're trying to help your brothers and your cousins, the one that you only know by nickname, Pooh Bear. But it's hard to breathe. But I guarantee you that God will give you the answer. You don't have to hide, men. It's available for you. Go on Amazon and pick that up. I guarantee you to bless you. This is for your pastor. Thank you, Dr. Jackson, for allowing me to come in here. I want to talk this morning about the illogical logic of our faith. The illogical logic of our faith. Everybody said the illogical logic of our faith. And I solicit your prayers. Please, when I get to heaven, while I know I'm going to be glad as a participant of the great coronation and celebration of God Almighty, if I get a chance to pull God to the side, I'm going to ask him this perplexing question, this earthly question that has run heavy on my mind for as long as I can remember in this Christian walk of life. I'm going to say, Lord, was there any other principle you could have left for the saints to live by other than our faith? Don't get me wrong. I know if you ask the average Christian, they could probably come up with a plausible definition for faith, such as one person might say faith is a belief with strong conviction, firm belief in something for which there may be no tangible proof, complete trust, confidence, reliance, or devotion. Another saint might say, faith is the opposite of doubt. And someone else may simply say, faith, according to the New Century Version of Hebrews 11:1, is being sure of the things we hope for and knowing that something is real even if we do not see it. But can we be real, y'all? How many of us like me are willing to admit that faith is good when you really don't need faith? Faith is good when you can just talk faith. But what happens when your back is against the wall? And you run out of all sensible options? Because I'll be the first to admit, I try to think my way out of stuff before I even go to God. I mean, I'm kind of smart. I went to Cookman, didn't I? So I'll try to figure it out. Anybody else try to figure it out? You go all over, you figure it out because you smart. You figure, yo, you don't need God for this. I know, I handle this one. I got this. But what happens when you run out of all of your sensible options? When you've already been praying beyond the stage of spiritual exhaustion where you're just tired of praying and it don't seem like God is listening and he sure ain't answering. And sometimes you're not sure of this concept of faith, or at best, you're not sure if this is the season for you to receive your desired answer. We just came down a few moments ago for prayer, but let's tell the truth. Some of us went back to our seats with the same problem, same issue, same ailment. How do I know? Because I watched y'all on screen last week and I saw some of y'all at the altar last week. How do I know? Because we keep coming back to the altar over and over again. Well, you're in good company, for the text that lies before us is one of my all-time favorites because of the reality of this man's plea to Christ Jesus while he was in the very presence of the Master himself. He says, Lord, I believe, but help me with the part of me that is filled with possible doubts. He ain't the only one. While on a ship with Jesus, with the storm out on the ocean that's tragically filling their boat with drowning, sinking water, the disciples said, Master, don't you care that we perish while you sleeping? That's not all. Remember the words of the children of Israel standing at the Red Sea when they cried in doubt to Moses because there was no graves in Egypt? You've taken us away to die in this wilderness? We told you, leave us alone. Don't carry us away from here. It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than for you to bring us out here and we die in the wilderness. Truth of the matter, my brothers and sisters, is that if we would be honest with ourselves, the only way we can truly trust in our faith is to admit that there is an illogical logic to faith. You know, illogical meaning not observing the principles of laws associated with logic. It makes no sense. And logic is that science that deals with the principles and criteria of validity, of inference and demonstration, the science of the formal principles of reasoning. So to have illogical logic means you're basing your belief on something that ain't even believable. And so as we've gathered today in these holy, sacred grounds at Antioch, where according to Acts 11 and 26, they were called Christians first. There's great evidence that in this place we hear both the voice of God and the instructions of God. This is the dwelling place. Let's affirm on today our illogical logic that says we trust God based on the following three things. Number one, we trust Him based on what we have heard about Him. Everybody say what we've heard about Him. Verse 17, the man says, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. The word brought in English is the past participle of bring, which means to convey, to lead, to carry, or cause to come along with one toward the place from which the action is being regarded. Thus meaning, based on what I heard, there is a desired result of which I can expect this to happen. Regardless of how doubtful my request may seem. Well, what is it that this man had heard? Well, according to Mark 6, verse 7, he had heard that the Lord had called his 12 disciples. And that the Lord had begun to send them forth two by two. And He gave them power over unclean spirits. Thus, to expect healing for a son was illogical logic. Because that's what he believes, based on what he's heard. You ever went to a restaurant that they said was good? You showed up just because that's what you heard, only to discover it wasn't that good. The real chef must not have been working today. You ever heard somebody say, go see this movie, and you go to the movie, and at the end you say, can I get my money back? This ain't what I thought I was going to expect to hear. Have you ever heard something only to get there to discover it ain't happening? He said, I brought my boy to your disciples, the ones I heard you had given power to, the ones that I heard they could lay hands on the sick and they would recover. I came all the way here just based on what I heard, only to discover they could do nothing. Maybe y'all ain't ever experienced nothing. But when your anticipation is up here only to get nothing, only to get nothing, not a little something, nothing. My boy is still sick. He's still foaming at the mouth. He still can't make it. I brought him all the way here. You don't even know how I had to get here. You don't know what I did to get to Antioch this morning. You don't know what I did only to discover that when I leave here, there's a possibility that I may end up saying I ain't get nothing. I put my best suit on this morning. I got Nothing. I put my best shoes on and I got nothing. I sat by from folk that I thought was going to help me get my praise on and I got nothing. So I trust him based on what I heard about him. But second of all, my illogical logic says I trust him based on what we have seen him do for others. Uh-oh. He says in verse 22, and oftentimes it cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him, but if thou can do anything, have compassion on us. The most interesting part of our case study of this text is the key word often found in the description of most of what Christ does when he performs a miracle on earth, and that is compassion. For of a truth, my brothers and sisters, it is the true reason why we have often seen others blessed, healed, set free, and delivered, not because we really deserve to be blessed, healed, set free, and delivered, but because of his compassion as a Savior. I've been saved longer than I've been delivered. You'll catch that on the way home. I was saved at age 9. I just got delivered from some stuff. I try not to cuss no more, but I ain't forgot how. I don't carry my gun no more, but I know where it is. You know what I'm saying? There's a thin line between who I was and who I am, and it don't take much to push me back on the other line. I'm on medication. You got to be careful. I can always use that as an excuse when I go off on you. I say, it's my meds. It's my meds. You got to be careful. Anybody else in here know that you can always use your medication to get you out of some stuff. One of my medications says it gives me diarrhea. Another one says it gives me constipation. I don't know how they both can work at the same time. But that's what makes me crazy. But God has compassion on me. He sees me and says, regardless of your craziness, I'm going to bless you anyhow. Regardless of what you did, I'm going to bless you anyhow. Regardless of how you doubt me, I'm going to bless you anyhow. I have illogical logic of my faith is because what I've seen the Lord do for others. Whoo! Grandmama used to sing a song, there is no secret what God can do, what he's done for others, he'll do for you. With his arms stretched open, he'll pardon you. Because there is no secret what the Lord can do. Third of all, lest I hold you too long, why do I have this illogical logic? It is based on the fact that what we with anticipation can expect of him, based on who we believe he is and what he is well able to do. Verse 23, 24 says, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible. To him that believeth, and straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. This man uses the most powerful illogical logic that I ever heard in these profound 7 words. Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. In other words, he admits that some of us, what some of us are too afraid to admit, in spite of our salvation, in spite of our church affiliation, in spite of our ministry assignment, in spite of our church position, We have to be honest in saying that there is a part of us that isn't so sure that God will answer our prayer. And that's based on three vulnerable truths. First of all, we ain't always been holy enough to request divine interventions. Whew. Sometimes I have to pray before I pray. Lord, I'm about to pray to you. You know what I did. I need you to bypass that. So when I really pray, you answer my prayer. Anybody here ever gone to God knowing you don't deserve this? You just told him you weren't going to do that no more, and then you did it again. We ain't always been holy enough. But second of all, we ain't through with some of our wicked ways. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that on the camera, but you do know there's some stuff y'all going to do again. Came down to the altar this morning, but you're going to do it again. Told the Lord forgive you, but you're going to do it again. No, it ain't good, but you're going to do it again. No, it ain't right, but you're going to do it again. I've been doing a series at our church on studies talking about the symptoms of Christianity. We save and still cuss. Symptoms. We save and still don't forgive folk. Symptoms. We save and still got a quick temper. Symptoms. We save and still bite. We save and still fornicate. Save, still commit adultery. Save. And we ain't through. Don't y'all admit it, but I know some of us, we ain't through. I ain't through. I know I ought to be, but I ain't through. Tell folk all the time, put me in a room of 1,000 things I don't like. You ain't got no problem. Put me in a room of one thing I crave. Somebody need to pray for me. Have me on your mind. Take the time and pray for me, because I ain't through. I want to be. I need to be. But I ain't. So why would he answer my prayer when he knows I ain't through? Don't raise your hand, but anybody in here can honestly say you ain't through? Don't wait. Just look straight ahead. Won't nobody know I'm talking to you. But I guarantee you, there's at least one more Melvin in here that can say, I ain't. I ought to be, but I ain't through. Third of all, here's my problem. We don't quite know God's full plan for our lives. I'm sure Jacob didn't know that he was going to end up with a limp when he wrestled with God. I knew Paul thought that when he prayed, the thorn was going to be removed. To hear God's answer, I ain't going to move it. I'm just giving you grace for it. We don't quite know what God's full plan. Am I going through this because this is a part of what God wants me to go through in my life? And yet I'm praying and crying, God, get rid of this thing. And he said, this is my plan. Huh? Yeah, this is my plan for you. This ain't what I planned, but this is what God planned. Oh, my God. Not to mention, y'all, just for the sake of a fourth reason, we're not always sure of the person's relationship with God that we're requesting help for. Lord, help my brother. You don't know what your brother did against God. Lord, help my friend. You don't know how bad your friend really is. You know how sometimes we be defending our friends and people say, if you only knew. Yeah, they act like that around you, but you need to see them in other places. And there you are praying, God, have mercy on them. And you don't know what relationship they have with God. And yet, my brothers and sisters, I wholeheartedly believe that if we can muster up the strength to seek out God and ask him based on our needs, based on our faith, that the Lord is able to do the rest. And this is where I want to leave you on today. For I contend that after you have made your request known unto God, knowing that all you have to hope with is your illogical logic, and trust that he's able to do just that, to do the rest, then step out of the way and let God do the rest. For the text records in the archive history of this story that Christ now does three things. First of all, he speaks to the problem. Verse 25 says, when Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him. Isn't it good to know, y'all, that God will speak to your problem? Can I get a witness in here? I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that the Lord knows what my problem is, and he knows how to speak to it. Second of all, he allows Satan just one last chance to test our faith. For the Bible says in verse 26, and the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, and he was as one dead, insomuch that many said, he is dead. Isn't it strange, y'all, that after we put our trust in God, God will sometimes let Satan have one more chance to bother us one more time? Isn't it strange, y'all, how when God says he'll do it, it still looks like Satan is having an advantage on our lives? Is there anybody here that's been praying and Satan's still working? You've been praying and Satan's still bothering you. You've been praying and Satan is still rumbling and tumbling with your life. That's God saying, I'm going to give you one more test to see if you really want me to do it for you. Last but not least, the text says he takes the boy by the hand and lifts him up. Can I get a witness in here? And this is where I'm leaving y'all on the day. Even if the Lord has the disciplining, even if the Lord has the chastisement, even if the Lord has to take me through a few more things, even if the Lord has to look like he's leaving me alone, as long as he has his hands on my life, as long as he has his hands on my situation, as long as he has his hands on my circumstance, I know I'm gonna be all right. Can I get a witness in him? For if he has his hands on me, I know I'll be able to rise above my fears. If he has his hands on me, I'll be able to rise above my doubts. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. If the Lord has his hands on my life, I'll be able to rise above my circumstances, above my situations. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. If the Lord has
has his hands on my life, I'll be able to run and tell somebody all you need is illogical logic, and God will work it out because he's able. Is there anybody in the house today that knows God is able to do anything but fail? Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. He's able to make ways out of no way. He's able to turn your midnight into day. He's able to fix it for your life. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. He's able to do whatever he wants to do, and there's nothing that Satan can stop when God got his hands on you. I dare you high five your neighbor and say, neighbor, God got his hands on your life. God got his hands on your family. God got his hands on your situation. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. God got his hands on your emotions, on your mind, on your spirit, on your soul, and it's gonna be all right. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. Tell somebody. I know it doesn't look like it, but you can stand on the promises of God based on your illogical logic. Lord, don't you see this Red Sea in front of us? Well, take the illogical logic of the staff you're holding in your hand and stretch it out and watch God do the rest for you. Lord, I've been sick 12 long years and I've spent all my money, but take your illogical logic, make your way through the crowd and say in that illogical logic, if I can just touch the hem of his garment and watch God work it out. Lord, I've been sitting at this pool 38 years, but take your illogical logic. Take up your bed. Begin to walk. Because that's all it takes. Doesn't take education. Doesn't take driving a Cadillac. Doesn't take living in a gated community. All it takes is, Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. What you believe? All things are possible. Nothing's impossible. Oh, all things are possible. Oh, Lord, I believe. If that's your testimony, lift your hands and say, Lord, Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. In all things, all things are possible. Can you say nothing is impossible? Nothing.
things impossible. Oh, all things. Oh, all possible. Oh, Lord, I believe.
Listen, there's somebody here today.
I know we already prayed. I know we already came to the altar. But somebody walked away not quite sure that the Lord was going to do it. You thought you had to do something incredible, some great bargaining issue with God. But God is saying, all I need you to have is some illogical logic. Trust me based on what you heard. Trust me based on what you've seen me do in others. Trust me based on the anticipation that you know that I'm not only able to do it, but I'm going to do it for you. And if that's you today, I want to pray with you. Just come to the altar.
Lord, I believe.
Come on, say it one more time. Lord,
Lord,
I believe.
All it takes is illogical logic, I guarantee it.
Lord, oh, I really do believe God.
What do you believe?
All things.
Oh,
nothing's impossible, no.
Come on, come on.
Apostle. Oh, Lord, I believe.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Lord,
there are about 12 more people. You know there's a situation going on in your life, and you've been having doubts about it. I guarantee you, if you come to the altar right now, God is going to trust your illogical logic, and he's going to bless you this week. Will you come?
Lord,
I see you coming. I see you.
I really do believe.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Lord. I'll never doubt of his abilities. Say, I believe, I believe, I believe. Yes, I do, yes, I do. Father, in the name of Jesus. Not because we're perfect, not because we've done everything right, not because we're going to be sinless when we leave this sanctuary, not because we got it all figured out, but simply based on three things. One, what we've heard about you. Well, I heard you're a healer. I heard you're a deliverer. I heard you can set free. Lord, I've heard about you. That's why I'm standing at the altar
Second of all, because of what I've seen you do in others, I've seen some folk who say you made a way out of no way. Because you've done it for them, I trust that you'll do it for me. But third of all, I did not get out of my seat without having anticipation and expectation that not only are you able to do it, but you got enough compassion to do it just for me. Just for me. Just for me. Just for me. Healing, just for me. Deliverance, just figuring it out, just for me. So I receive it. This time when I go to my seat, I'm going with a great assurance that none of what you're doing has anything to do with me. But it has to do with the fact that you ain't gonna let your name be defeated. You won't let your name be defeated. You will not allow your name to be defeated. And I now become a poster child of who God heals, of who God delivers, of who God makes a way for, of who God turns things around for. Hallelujah. I'll testify, woo, that it was the goodness of the Lord. And so I thank you for what you're doing for these at the altar. We confirm it by lifting our hands and saying, can't make me doubt it, know too much about it, and I know my life is in his hands. I believe, sure enough believe, I believe. I won't even put an amen to the prayer because I know some of y'all need to give God some praise all the way home. So in the name of Jesus, go in your deliverance. Go in your healing. Go in God saying, I got you. Go in the assurance that it's going to be all right. I believe. Listen. While we're standing, do me a favor, check your neighborhood. The person on the right, the person on the left, the person in front of you, the person behind you. Ask them two questions. One, neighbor, are you saved? Ask them. Say, don't smile, I'm not a dentist, I can't read teeth. Yes or no, are you saved? Yes, no, yes, no. Question number two, in the same neighborhood. Ask them, neighbor, do you have a church home? Ask them, do you have a church home? Do you have a church home? Do you have a church home? Yes or no? Because everybody that come to church ain't got a church home. And then guess what? Because we have some visitors, I ain't putting nobody on the spot. But because they have visitors, you got to look at somebody one more time and ask them this question. Are you growing where you're going?
All right. Good question, Reverend.
Because maybe that's why you're here this morning, because where you're going, you ain't growing. So listen, if anybody said no to any of those three questions, God is prophetic. He placed you right where you are to bid them invitation and welcome to be a part of this dwelling place, the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church. Will there be one? You said no to one of them questions. This is your day. This is your day. This is your day. This is your day. I believe. I see you, my sister. I believe. Somebody else. I believe. Watch this. Somebody said, I did not come.
come to church to join today, but I'm feeling kind of funny. But guess what? That must be Jesus. Because Satan would never give you a good idea about joining the Lord's side. So if you're feeling funny, that's the Lord speaking. So bring your funny feeling self on down here and come on, join the church. Will there be somebody? Come on. I believe, yeah, yeah. I believe. Say, I believe. I see you. I believe. I believe. Sure enough, believe. Say, I believe. Somebody else, somebody else. I believe. Oh, oh, oh. One more thing and I'm done. So Paul tells his story about the Damascus journey. He tells it to this dude named Agrippa. Probably was black, because that sounded like a black name, don't it? Agrippa. Dirty Red, Gripper, Tay-Tay, Gripper. Yeah. After hearing this, Agrippa says, almost thou persuaded me. There's somebody here right now saying, boy, if he'd have talked 30 more seconds, I'd have walked down that aisle. So guess what? I got a second hand on my watch, and I'm giving you 30 more seconds. So bring your Agrippa cell phone down here. You know this is a good persuasion. Come on and join the Lord's house today. Come on, come on, come on. Say, I believe. I believe, sure enough believe, I really believe, made up my mind, I'm gonna serve the Lord, I believe. God bless you. Thank you.
Amen. Can we give God some praise for these three that have come? Hallelujah. Amen. Listen, we just want to love on you. Get to know you a little better. And we're just grateful to God that you have made Antioch your church and your church home. Amen. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Father God, we thank you for these individuals that have come. And Father, we pray that you will be good stewards over those you have entrusted to us. So God, I ask that you will be with them now. That you, according to your word, will forgive them of their sins. That you would cleanse them from all unrighteousness. That you would allow them to enjoy sweet fellowship with you by the power of the Holy Spirit. Give them an awesome experience, we pray. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, I want you to follow Minister Teresa to the back. Amen. We just want to get some information from you. Amen. Come on, let's give them some encouragement. Were you blessed today? Come on, were you really blessed? Don't fool me now. Were you really blessed today? Amen. Thank God for the message and the messenger. Amen. Listen, I'm going to pray, but of course, as soon as I'm finished praying, we know that our seniors will go first. Amen. And so we want to prepare ourselves for that. Let's look to the Lord. Father God, we thank you now for this time that we have spent in your presence. We thank you for your word to our hearts. Help us to live accordingly. So bless us now to this end and for this cause. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, and abide with us both now and forevermore. Amen. You may be dismissed. Seniors, you can go first.